What do you do about that? And the reality is, I know several people who chose not to disclose, or several people who chose not to pursue that career. So there are substantial consequences to the folks who choose to pursue this pathway that I think we are starting to learn as an industry. That discussion has started at the NTSB in a very substantial level recently. So I'm very excited today to welcome Brian Bonhoff, who is the founder and the executive director of the Pilot Mental Health Campaign. So Brian, if you would come to the front, please. So let's have a round of applause for Brian. Brian's going to talk to you about his work.
Thank you so much, and thank you to Will and Rebecca and everyone at the Alaska Air Carriers Association for hosting us for what we believe is a very important conversation on this topic. So thank you so much. We deeply appreciate it. So my name is Brian Bonhoff. I'm the founder of the Pilot Mental Health Campaign. We are the first nationwide nonprofit advocacy organization dedicated specifically to looking at the issue of pilot mental health and making recommendations as to how we can do better. We're guided by the belief that every person should have equal and equitable access to modern, clinically appropriate mental health care, regardless of pilot status. We also believe that preventative mental health care is not an indicator of risk, but an indicator of good health. So today's presentation, I just gave you the intro. We're gonna do a little historical background, crossroads that we're now in, and then we're going to talk about potential paths moving forward. Unlike most conversations on this topic, we won't be going over specific forms or current policies and procedures in too much depth other than their relevance to mental health. So history, where did the aeromedical system come from? It's complicated and it goes a very long way back. So the aeromedical system really developed in the 1920s, 19-teens and 1930s, and was especially impacted by the fact that in World War II, the Army Air Force noticed that a lot of their pilots who were newly minted pilots were not doing well. They had a large percentage of accidents that they traced back to pilot error. Many of those pilot error accidents were traced back to medical issues. This was before they had medical clearances. And so they decided, obviously, this is a really big deal. And so they began issuing medical certificates in 1927. And back then it was about 4,000 in that year. And this year it's probably close to around 500,000 a year. The Federal Aviation Administration came into being in 1958. It was incorporated into the Department of Transportation a decade later. And many of the actions that was taken by the Civil Aviation Board and the language actually moved over to the FAA, and a lot of those original policies you can actually still see remnants of in today's regulations. So the FAA Authorization Act gave the FAA statutory authority by Congress to implement regulations. We all know how this works. So the criteria for a medical certificate is not pilot proficiency. This is an important note. It's not testing your ability to fly a plane well or safely. It is testing for the presence or lack of presence of a disqualifying or qualifying condition. And this leads to the situation that many pilots find themselves in. I'll just read part of this quote for you. This is from a FAA document about the aeromedical system in 1971. It's a timely document. I mean, it reads, other than some gender pronoun stuff, it reads like a document from today. Unfortunate when such a physician unknowingly prescribes a certain course of therapy, perhaps surgery, that is one of several alternatives, and in making the choice, takes away the career of his patient pilot. Why would this happen? I mean, we all know this happens. And it happens because there's a difference between the kind of medicine that you and I, anyone in the general population, enjoys, and regulatory medicine, which is more having the AME, a designated professional, make sure that you fit the standards of the regulations that are determined by the regulatory body, in this case, the FAA. So from the regulator's point of view, this is great because everything is standardized. It's based on knowable, testable standards in theory. You have comparable results, so you can compare one airman to another, and you have a track record. So with an individualized view of medicine, which is what most of the general population gets, you don't necessarily have these things in an aviation spectrum. You do have them in just medical data. So we have regulatory medicine and patient-centered medicine. Regulatory medicine fits Part 67. Patient-centered medicine is what the general population gets most of the time. Why does that matter? So the conversation today is around mental health and aviation. And this is part of 67107, which is where those regulations are documented in the FARs. So the ones that are actually disqualifying, permanently disqualifying in most cases, personality disorder, psychosis, delusions, bipolar disorder, substance dependence that is not treated or in remission, and no other personality disorder, neurosis, or other mental condition. I would argue, and I think a lot of people would argue, that the first few on that list, it makes a lot of sense as to why you would want to screen for those things. You would not want someone with psychosis or delusional flying an airplane in the NAS. But that last one is kind of vague, especially where it says, or other mental condition. And that gives the Federal Air Surgeon and the Office of Aerospace Medicine a lot of leeway in what they determine is and isn't aeromedically significant. So I don't think I have to explain this too much. I feel like most Americans know pretty well, even if they don't know the exact numbers. And it's not just an American problem. I mean, this is a global issue. Especially since the pandemic, we've seen a significant rise in nearly all mental health disorders, especially depression, especially anxiety among young people. Nearly all of them have gone up. About half of Americans will report at some time in their life that they experience the symptoms of a clinically diagnosable mental health disorder. Usually depression is the most common. Particularly alarming stat is that 18% of 12 to 17 year olds seriously considered suicide. And this data is from 2020. This is before the pandemic. One in five Americans has some sort of mental health disorder. It's incredibly common. So aviation, where we are right now, has been impacted by a variety of factors, some of which you could see coming, some of which I think you really couldn't have. So we have dramatically advanced social norms, which means we talk about mental health. I think that's generally a good thing. When more people are talking about it, more people know that it's a serious issue, especially in the aviation context. I mean, I'd like to see this talked about more in SMS systems. I mean, I think it is a safety issue. But societal norms, you can't argue. The way we talk about depression, anxiety today, just different than we did even 10, 15 years ago, let alone in the 80s, when a lot of the aeromedical regulations were kind of put together in their current form, more or less. We have a revolution in treatment protocols. So beginning in the 70s through the 80s, you have the SSRIs brought on the market. And then just the last like 5, 10, 15 years, even more advancements in depression treatment, anxiety treatment, PTSD treatment. We're making real progress in this area. Increased access to care. There are more care facilities. More people have insurance than ever. This is giving people access to mental health care. New information space. So pros and cons here. Pro, you know about it. You can talk about it with your friends. You're more aware. You're more educated. Cons, social media, especially for young people, you have that social comparison factor. That's a big thing, a big part of the reason that many people in this generation have increased anxiety, increased depression, among other reasons. So mixed bag in the new information space. So you have people who were brought up on that top line, used to that, and they're colliding with number five there, the old information space, which is what we all know, the current regulations and systems at the FAA. Then you have the 2020 pandemic. All of this combined with static regulatory standards has led to a condition right now where, I mean, the backlog is hundreds, if not thousands, for mental health conditions, for special issuances. Last time I heard, we're looking at about 18 months if you want to be on an SSRI. And even just mild depression, if you note that on the form, this could be a potential, not a roadblock, an absolute roadblock, but a temporary roadblock. And it scares a lot of people away. So here are those special issuance stats. The initial disqualification rate is about 20% for people who note mental health diagnoses on their form. And according to the most recent data I've heard, about 30% of medical applications are coming in with some kind of mental health disorder mentioned on there. And so obviously, you can see for yourselves what happened right after the pandemic. And it makes perfect sense. I mean, kids were away from school, people left their jobs, people lost their jobs. It was an extremely traumatic time. It makes perfect sense why depression, anxiety, physical ailments all went up after and during the pandemic. So United States antidepressant usage, and this number, 13.2%, is sort of the median. Different groups, different populations have very widely differing uses of antidepressants. This is the average number across the population. And so the majority of Americans obviously do not. And this is a point in time reference, not a have you ever in your life reference. So this is US pilot antidepressant use. And we're not arguing all pilots should be on antidepressants. But it is worth noting that the population prevalence of antidepressant usage versus the pilot prevalence of antidepressant usage is statistically impossible. And it can't happen. So why is that? Why does that data not match up? And why is it so far outside the norm, way outside standard deviation, way beyond what you would ever expect? Well, it's because pilots are perfect all the time. Everyone's happy. It's all good. There's nothing to worry about. This quote was taken from Reddit, from a pilot forum. Let's read the end of it. Life is perfect 100% of the time, always, or else. I love the FAA, and I'm happy 100% of the time, or else. I took that one because it had the most likes, about 2,000. So the number of pilots who currently go through the protocol, which is called, it used to be called the SSRI pathway. It's now called the antidepressant pathway. They added Wellbutrin last summer. That was on top of the four antidepressants of the SSRI class that they already allowed, Lexapro, Prozac, Zoloft, and another one. 522 are currently flying on that protocol. And you compare that to the number of people in the HIMSS program who are currently flying who have recovered from substance use disorders, that's about 3,000. And if you look at population prevalence and you compare it to the pilot population, you should have around 54,000 pilots who might be on some type of medication like this. And I'm using medication specifically because it's easier to get data on this from the FAA than say, a diagnosis, which is more vague, but it tells you the underlying story in a really clear way. So, mental health treatment and awareness are at all-time highs. I don't think we can argue too much about that. And we also have more people in need than ever. I don't think there's much arguing about that. So why are so few pilots seeking treatment? Well, there are lots of barriers. And the barriers are different for different people. They're different for different populations. They're different for third, second, or third class. They're different dependent on your job. Stigma, culture, fear of uncertainty. The cost of treatment is a huge one. Not just the cost of treatment itself, but then the cost of getting yourself back into the cockpit. That can run thousands and thousands of dollars. For many young pilots, it's simply not doable. And then, of course, you have the potential of certificate loss, which is low. Most pilots will not lose their certificates because of a mental health disorder. I should point that out. And I'll just go ahead and point out the fact that if anyone in this room is struggling with a mental health disorder, there is a path. There is a proven path forward for you. It's clunky, but it is there. So don't think that there are no options. So we believe some of these barriers, in addition to societal barriers, occupational barriers, professional barriers, cultural barriers, we believe some of these barriers might actually come from the regulations themselves. I think we've all seen this form. If you have a pilot's license, you've certainly seen this form. If you've applied for a medical, it hasn't changed all that much over the years. And on its face, it seems pretty reasonable. I mean, you would want pilots in the NAS to go through some sort of clearance to make sure that they're not a risk to themselves, a risk to passengers, a risk to anyone on the ground. That all makes sense. The form itself is a little vague, and aviation attorneys make a lot of money because that form is a little vague. Mental disorders of any sort, depression, anxiety, etc., at any time in your life, ever. I mean, and it doesn't say diagnosed necessarily. It says had, presently have. I mean, it gives the applicants a lot of leeway to interpret that. A lot of people get stuck here. If you do want to go on an antidepressant, you have this flowchart to reference, which I have to admit is a vast improvement over the flowcharts that were available in, say, 2010. It is easier to go through it today. It is more clear. There's more guidance than there was in the beginning. It is nonetheless a very complex and highly regulated process. These are just some of the things that you would need for that process: a personal statement, treatment records, a HIMSS-trained COG screen administration. That's a unique test that is licensed by the FAA, but actually developed by a private company that is designed to test neuropsychological abilities specifically related to aviation. But the maker of that test would admit freely that the test isn't specifically designed to calculate pilot performance. It is designed to detect a cognitive deficit of some sort. And the way that a deficit is defined is it's on a bell curve, basically. So they look at thousands of pilots who take this test. There's norms. There's outside the norm. If you go down this pathway, you'll also be subjected to the neuropsychology test battery that the FAA requires everyone to go through. The number of tests will depend on the individual. A lot of it is left up to the practitioner themselves as they decide how to evaluate you. But some of them are required: the IQ test, the Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory, the MMPI. The MMPI-2 is a huge piece of that puzzle that they use. It's hundreds of questions long. I believe that version was developed in the 80s. The current version is the MMPI 3. So how do aviators navigate this process? And I should take just a moment here, because I know that we have public servants in the room from the FAA, and I want to be explicitly clear. I know PMHC knows that not everyone in the FAA is okay with every policy within the FAA. This is how all organizations work. We are talking specifically about a very small number of policies within the aeromedical division. And so these are nonprofit organizations, sometimes for-profit organizations, that can help you put together your application. You essentially pay them to help you make sure you do the paperwork correctly. And a lot of these organizations, I mean, I've worked with some of them in the past. AMAS is great, AOPA is great. I mean, they offer a lot of help in for situations where people really don't know where to go. People don't know what path to take. And those organizations are great. But we have to ask ourselves, why would organizations like that be necessary for pilots? And why would pilots have better outcomes if they choose a paid consultant versus just doing it themselves? This is an example. If you go ahead and do that, if you get to this point, you declare ground, report, treatment, stabilize, wait 6 months, gather your records, take the COGS training neuropsychological evaluation. HIMSS-AME has to sign off, lots of acronyms, as you all know. Assemble the package, submit it, wait another 6 months. That second 6 months is just the backlog. That's just the FAA backlog. So that's variable based on what their stats look like at the moment. And they have made improvements. A few years ago, they had one psychologist on staff who was reviewing all of these. I believe they have four now. So they have made progress, no doubt about that. But when people are deciding whether or not to get treatment, they look at this, they look at friends who have gone through this process, they hear stories, and then they consider this. This is what happens if you don't disclose. Now, you risk being caught. It's a serious crime. You could have your license pulled, you could have your medical pulled at the very least. But people do this. Thousands of people do this. So this invasive process definitely can help mitigate safety in some cases, usually the more severe cases on the severe end of the spectrum. In theory, this should work pretty well. The evidence has grown a little bit. So the FAA keeps evidence from the SSRI protocol, for example. Since 2010, pilots in that program have been doing very well. That's what their data shows. And that's good to know. But that's really the only data point they have. There's not a whole lot of aviation-specific research on this topic, as you can imagine. I mean, it's hard to get research participants who are pilots to sign up for a study that's going to ask them about their mental health and background. So does this approach have side effects? How many of you in the room have seen this, the 56% number? It's new to most of you. So this was done by an Air Force researcher named Dr. William Hoffman. He was looking for research on healthcare avoidance amongst pilots. And what he found was, and this was one of the first studies that looked at this topic specifically, which is kind of shocking because it just came out a couple years ago, 56% of pilots reported a history of avoiding healthcare behavior due to fear of losing their medical certificate. And I think if you've been in aviation long enough, the number is actually higher than I would have thought, but the fact that it occurs doesn't really surprise me. I don't think it surprises most people. 27% of pilots admitted to basically falsifying information on the medical form, basically lying about their history, a diagnosis, something like that, for fear of certificate loss. That was a survey of about 5,000 pilots, by the way, so pretty decent sample. One of our board members is a woman named Lila Stein. She is a recent graduate of Western Michigan University from their aerospace program. She is very interested in research on college students, collegiate aviators. And I think we should all be concerned about collegiate aviators because they are the future of aviation. So I won't make you read all this, but I have a couple highlights I'd like to pull out. So she asked a group of just over 200 aviation students, mostly at Western Michigan, but also at other colleges, in what way have the FAA's rules affected your desire to seek professional mental health assistance? And note this question doesn't say therapy, medication, all it says is mental health assistance. And they made sure that the participants understood that that was just anything. 46.77% said it negatively affected their desire to seek care. In a generation that has so many problems, I think we can call them problems, I like Generation Z, but of all the generations, I mean the social change they've seen in their lives, the technological change, the pandemic, and this is what young people think about getting help in aviation systems. This one is even worse. If someone you trust said you can see a mental health professional and keep your FAA medical, to what extent would you believe them? More than half said that they would not believe that person, even if it was someone they trusted, even if this information came from a friend. That should be a shocking number for anyone who's interested in the future of the pilot workforce. This system does have consequences. This is a man named John Hauser. John was a student at UND in 2021. He was on their professional aviation program. Great student, very bright, smart, outgoing, had lots of friends. But John was secretly struggling with something that no one knew. He told no one about. And then in a letter that he wrote to his parents, he described why he didn't tell anyone about the problems he was facing. And he specifically cited FAA regulations. And this was in the last letter that he ever wrote. The fact that any young person is thinking about that when they're deciding whether or not to seek mental health treatment, there's something profoundly wrong with a system where this can take place. Mr. Hauser unfortunately did pass away. He died by suicide in his airplane in 2021. His parents have since set up a foundation at UND to work on this topic, and they've made great progress. So it moves around from different aviation colleges. I was at their conference at Middle Tennessee State University back in October. They are making progress, but it's an uphill battle, as many of you can imagine. But people outside aviation are starting to notice this. And what they notice, they don't really like. Journalists, policymakers, they're reading stories like this and they're thinking, okay, what's going on with our pilot population? What exactly is happening here? And granted, many of these articles came out after the October event on the Horizon Airlines flight. Can I play a video? Will it click? I can also just describe it if it won't play. Yeah, I can just click it. No worries. Okay, so PMHC was very lucky to be invited to the NTSB's roundtable on mental health. I had the quotes just in case the video didn't work, but I highly recommend that you do watch that video. The first session is about just over an hour long. They include the stories of many people who have been affected by the system, including the mother of John Hauser. She testified. So did Lila Stein, that young woman that I mentioned earlier. She testified. It is worth watching. And keep in mind, this is the head of the NTSB. We all know what they do. They are tasked with investigating accidents and making safety recommendations. And she said specifically, let me be clear, the safety risk comes from a culture of silence around mental health, not about seeking help. The fact that the chair of the NTSB, first of all, had this roundtable at all, the fact that she said that openly and publicly, that's kind of a big deal. It's a bit of a wake-up call for our industry. And I'll just go ahead and read the larger quote. No one should have to think twice about their job before seeking help. And yet here we are today, because that's not currently the case in aviation. It's somewhat of an open secret that current policies incentivize people to either lie about their medical history when it comes to mental health or avoid seeking help in the first place. So this is on the NTSB's radar as a safety issue, not just a healthcare issue, but a safety issue. So what happens next? I think we're at a crossroads when it comes to aeromedical certification, especially as it relates to mental health. I think it's time for us to set a new course. So for one thing, mental health is not binary. I think this is intuitive. I think everyone knows this. But when you have a form that says yes, no, there's no maybe option, it's just yes, no, you're putting it through a flow chart, through a checklist, which works in aviation. We love our checklists for a good reason. Checklists save lives. But when you're trying to analyze someone, someone's mind, a personality, a person with history, those checkboxes don't always tell the full story. Also, when someone says, I'm depressed, they could be grieving from the loss of a loved one. They could have a mild disorder that may or may not be treated. Or if they say they're depressed, they could be nearly catatonic, in bed, not thinking about anything. That is a spectrum. It's not a yes or no. Kind of like what I just mentioned, two different machines. One is well suited to checklists and flowcharts. One is not. And again, flowcharts and checklists have their place, especially in aviation. I really do believe that. But when you're looking at the human psyche and psychology, it gets tricky. One size fits all. So we have first, second, third class medicals. Obviously, we have different classes of safety, depending on what kind of aircraft you're flying, under what rules you're flying. That all makes sense. The mental health regulations around pertaining to mental health don't vary all that much based on first, second, or third class. That's kind of strange in that a lot of the regulations do vary a little bit, but that one doesn't. So you have someone in a single engine Cessna who wants to fly around by themselves recreationally. They have to go through that same battery of neuropsychological testing that someone at a 121 carrier does. It's an open question as to whether or not that should be necessary. They are sharing the NAS together, but the overall risk, I would argue, is relatively low for that third class pilot. So right now, when you declare that you have a mental health disorder, usually that's groundable. You have to ground yourself because the FAA will need evidence. They'll need documentation. They need to clear you, yes or no. Instead of grounding, might there be a better way for pilots to disclose, to let people know that they have something going on, let their AME know that there's something going on, let someone in authority know so that the system knows that this person is being monitored, this person is safe. But right now what we do is we just take them out of the community totally. And so this is just one model of depression. There are a bunch of models, but this one is meaning, belonging, and support. And then in this Venn diagram, you see the things that come from support, belonging, and meaning. Belonging, meaning, and support, a lot of people derive that from flying. Flying is their life, flying is their culture, flying is their family. And when they lose their medical certificate, that often gets taken away from them, or at least they believe that it's been taken away from them. So keys to a better system. What might a better system look like? I think there are a lot of examples out there that are worth investigating. Just culture. I think people need to be able to disclose without fear of losing their jobs, without fear of losing something they love. Be able to disclose and have that risk assessed on a scale. Is it groundable? Is it not groundable? Is this something we should just monitor closely? Trust. Trust is lacking in the current system. This is a safety issue, as you can imagine. And a just culture ideally doesn't have that big of a trust gap. I mean, people unwilling to talk about, there's distrust between pilots and AMEs. There's distrust between AMEs and the FAA. There's distrust between different branches within the FAA and different AMEs. It's a really difficult space to navigate for a lot of pilots. New therapies. So the FAA understandably likes track records of therapies. That's one of the main reasons that the SSRIs are, quote, legal and the others are not, is because they've been around since the late 80s and their side effect profile is also pretty mild compared to a lot of other antidepressants. Unfortunately, when you only limit therapies that fit that mold that were developed in the late 80s or early 90s, and you say everything else is not okay, well, not everyone's brain is the same. So some people respond to different medications, and looking at just the side effect profile isn't necessarily relevant unless you look at the side effect profile as it affects that patient. because they vary widely. I mean, even in SSRI, you can have serious side effects, whereas a different class of antidepressant for a different person might work better. Also, this is really important because the field of depression and anxiety research is evolving really quickly. I mean, there have been a lot of exciting advancements in the last 5 years, and I think the next 5 years is going to be even more exciting. So there's a question. Based on our assumption of risk, how many of these new treatments that could be life-changing will we deny pilots? It's something to think about. And then the other thing to think about is, and what would the risk to the system be if you went ahead and allowed that therapy while monitoring that individual? Best practices, the FAA already has a lot of best practices to take from. SMS, all the studies over the years that they've done, they have a lot of great data. I would argue they should use more of it in regards to aeromedical regulation. Fairness, this is also related to trust. I mean, people need to feel like a system is not punishing them unduly. Because right now, when you're grounded for 2 years for taking an SSRI, a lot of people feel like that is disproportionate. And then their friends see that, and they think it's disproportionate, and then they hide. They don't want to get treatment. Efficiency, I don't think there's any arguing that any organization, but especially government organizations, could use a software update. And I know that that's particularly hard, but it does need to be done. And to their credit, the FAA is making progress. So you can now see the status of your medical online. Your doctor can now submit documents via email or email portal directly to the FAA. So they're slowly moving in the right direction, but it needs to move faster. Innovation and evidence. Evidence is a huge one. You'd be surprised how little evidence there is to back up the current regulations. And they freely admit that, but they will also say that given the lack of evidence, therefore we must lean towards being extremely conservative. And when they make that calculation, what they mean is we're saying treatment has risk. We know that there is risk with treatment. What they don't include in that calculation necessarily is how does the system push people away or encourage people to come in? And if it's having a net effect of pushing people away, that is a huge problem. Some other frameworks to explore. Basic med arguably would not work for 121 carriers. I get that, but it is an interesting model. Trust is bigger in basic med. MeSafe, if you are really interested in this topic and have time to read hundreds of pages, the European Union has published what I would call a groundbreaking document. It goes through medication by medication, condition by condition, sort of the beginning of realigning EASA's standards on this topic, multi-year study. The, I never say this right, salutogenic model. This is a paper from Australia. It was published in ICAO, I think 2 years ago. Salutogenic is distinct from pathogenic. So they describe pathogenic as the way that we currently define disease in the system, which kind of like I mentioned earlier, it's not are you okay to fly, it's do you have a condition, yes, no. They're moving towards or would like to move towards a system that emphasizes a more holistic view that incorporates input from not just AMEs, but also that person's CFI, other people in their lives. And then a big one is a performance-based system. So Dr. William Hoffman, whose research I quoted earlier, he's a big fan of the performance-based system. What that means is instead of having a point-in-time reference, which is essentially your AME appointment, you would have an ongoing system. And how exactly this would be done is an open question for him and many others. It's possible you could have a smartphone app that kind of does like a mini cog screen that keeps track of your mood. Obviously, there would be privacy concerns to be worked out. But imagine a system where a pilot was able to somehow keep track of how they're doing, notice when they're not doing well, when their performance is going down, and then voluntarily say, you know what, my performance is really suffering right now. I think I need help. I'm going to go ahead and ground myself. And imagine if the consequences weren't immediate grounding for 6 months, followed by a huge backlog of paperwork. Something to think about. So a final quote from Chair Hamady from that roundtable. What's unsafe is pretending the status quo is acceptable. I agree. I think it's time for a new approach. So the pilot mental health campaign has only been around about 6 months. We're a very young advocacy organization, but we've already accomplished a lot. So what we do is legislative advocacy, grassroots mobilization, regulatory outreach, and public education. Our aim is to bring as many people as possible into this conversation, not exclude anyone. All opinions on this are valid and needed, but it is time that we start talking about this issue in a different way. I think the current conditions demand that. And so in terms of regulatory, right now the FAA is currently in the midst of a aviation rulemaking committee, which was announced in early December, and that's scheduled to wrap up March 31st. So pretty quickly, actually. And they're charged with investigating the barriers that people face when they're attempting to access mental health care. So a huge task for them. I don't know who's on the ARC, but when they do release their findings, they'll release the membership as well as recommendations. And then the rulemaking process begins with the public notice and comment period. That's one route, the FAA reauthorization. Hopefully we get a reauth next month. Hopefully we get funding for the FAA sooner rather than later. There's some provisions in there. They have some proposed working groups. There's some good options there. But grassroots mobilization and public education we're also working on because we think not enough policymakers know about this. We think not enough people in the medical community know about this. We think a lot of doctors unknowingly get their patients into trouble with the FAA, not because it's their fault, not because it's the FAA's fault, but there's a miscommunication between those two worlds. We need to help bridge that gap. So that's PMHC. That's who we are. That's what we're doing. If you are so interested, we will be in Washington, D.C. next month on March 12th. This will be our first big lobby day. We went there last month after the NTSB event, had some great conversations with congressional offices. We'll be meeting with even more congressional offices. The main point of this visit is just education, because in a culture of silence, our policymakers don't know what's going on. So we just need to explain this to them in terms that they understand and let them know that this is something that the FAA is looking into, but it's something aviation as a whole really needs to look into as well. So you're welcome to join us. That's the RSVP link. Do I take questions or is that okay? Any questions? And if you don't have any publicly available questions, you can always email info@pmhc.org. I found that a lot of people have thoughts on this issue, and that understandably they're concerned about voicing them in public. So info@pmhc.org. I review all of those personally. Not many other people in our organization see that email account. So you can send those our way via that. Yes, sir.
So have you partnered with any of the other organizations such as,
whoa, that's really bad, with such as AFSP or NAMI and on these discussions, especially up on the Hill?
Excellent question. So this space has moved so quickly that we have not had as many of those conversations as we would have liked at this point. We were kind of expecting to ramp up beginning now. Events of the last few months kind of pushed us earlier. But we will be reaching out to those organizations, absolutely.
So I raise that question because I sit on the state board for the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention here in Anchorage. And one of the things, hearing these conversations going on and hear from you and the presentation on pilots and people in the air carrier industry, it's pretty critical. The one thing that is a little bit different maybe on where your direction is headed is AFSP or NAMI, which is the mental illness, you know, the National Alliance for Mental Illness, and that looks at prevention, and what are some of those causes, and I want to make sure that people within this room and also, you know, give a couple of shout outs to organizations for supporting it. But AFSP actually here in Alaska will go to your business and do presentations on mental health for you and your employees or whatever. And the presentation that is done is called Talk Saves Lives. And there's some real scary numbers with all this stuff that, occur. And you brought up 1 in 5 people have mental health issues and that sort of thing. But the suicide rate is really, really high. Alaska, for those of you that don't know, is now the third is projected to be the third highest in the country. Alaska has, the suicide rate in the state has gone up 55% since 2005. So these are numbers that are really shocking. It's really staggering. It impacts people, especially flight crews and first responders, rural Alaska, and that sort of thing. So if anyone wants any information on it, you know, feel free to catch me as well. More than happy, but I'm going to give a couple of shout outs just because they are big supporters for that. It's Alaska Airlines, Scott. I've got Susan Hoshaw with Everett's Air Cargo sitting behind. Everett supports this, and Grant Aviation has been a big supporter of this as well, starting last year. So it's really critical for us to catch this and prevent, not just put regulations in place and prevent people from coming forward, but we need to see the signs.
Absolutely, thank you so much for that. And my presentation today was more about a systemic policy point of view. There is a huge conversation that absolutely must be advanced based on organizational culture. How do we talk about this? Yeah, I would love to partner with you or any other organizations because it absolutely, absolutely needs to be done. Absolutely. And just like you mentioned, I mean, there are best practices around this issue. There are procedures. There are things you can do to make a huge difference. And picking up your phone is one of them, or even just a text message every now and then to your friends. Just check in. Huge deal. Yes. Thank you.
I appreciate your presentation. Thank you very much. I think the data is probably wrong as I think through my friend group or professional pilot group. You know, I think it's closer to 90% of professional pilots are not going to talk about mental health. 99% are not going to talk to a therapist. And this is the simplest aspect because as you it's stigmatized, right? Now there's a lot of data associated with it, but hell no, you can't talk about it because the FAA is going to ground you. And it's a serious problem. It's something I think that's going to be our biggest problem in terms of like, we're going to do everything we can to safely operate through SMS programs, all that kind of stuff. But the human capital side and the impact of the new generations coming through living in COVID and all the geopolitical issues we have, I think it's much higher. It's a much bigger problem. The FAA needs to get it together and say, you know, maybe there's certain things you could do that we don't even care about. If you had a death in the family and you wanted to talk to a mental health professional, somebody who this is their job, have at it. You know, if they're, you know, I didn't go to, other than my annual exams, I did not want to get blood work until I like felt like my heart was going to explode one year. I was like, I better go get some blood work. And I had super high cholesterol. And then I told my parents that. I was like, oh, they're like, oh yeah, we're on cholesterol medication. My, you know, dad got on it when it was approved by the FAA. It's like, shoot, I wish somebody would have told me about that, because, you know, now everything totally level, because like an atorvastatin is not a big deal. You could report it. You don't have to go through this paperwork nightmare. You're not going to lose your medical, all that kind of stuff. The mental health aspect, just being healthy in the head, probably 100%, you know, pushed to the side. You know, I say 99% because maybe there's somebody who actually addresses it, but because of the medical process and that big complicated flow chart you showed up there, and oh no, it's okay, you could report it. Yeah, right, you can't. Like, that's the problem. And we're going to be in a serious world of hurt as new generations come into this industry. And then a lot of the people who aren't going to come into this industry because of the barriers just to be healthy.
Thank you for pointing that out. I mean, I have met so many young people who have chosen not to pursue aviation as a career or as a passion because of these regulations. And sometimes it's something serious, but usually it's not. It's like a sleeping pill that isn't authorized, and then they get off the sleeping pill, and then they still have to go through all this paperwork because maybe that sleeping pill is also used as an anxiety or antidepressant. And you're absolutely right that there's the policy side of things, and we need to do work on that. And then there's the organizational culture side of things, and that's going to take much longer to change. But that's why everyone in this room needs to be a part of this conversation, because I don't see how you change just the policies without being able to change some of the organizational culture components about this, which are undoubtedly safety issues, but they're also just healthcare issues. I mean, you want healthy, safe employees. Everyone does. They want to live in an environment where they feel supported. That's not strange. So we have a lot of work to do on a lot of fronts, but I do feel like we're actually making a little bit of progress, which is nice. Thank you, sir. Anyone else? Well, I won't keep you all from lunch. I really do appreciate everyone who watched this. If you have any questions, we have a booth. We'll be out there, pmhc.org. Yeah, thank you all so much.
Okay, one more round of applause for Brian, please. Okay, a couple of notes. I know you're getting hungry. If you smelled the burger bar, I understand why. Before we get started there, at 12:45, we will have videos from the delegation. So I encourage you to be back in this space. Please bring your lunch with you so you can see those. And then at 1 o'clock, that aviation software panel has moved to 3 p.m. So just a reminder there, it'll be in the Turnigan room. And finally, please bid on the silent auction. It's still live. Okay, everybody, you are free to go get a burger. Thanks.
PetSmart carries Hill's Science Diet puppy food with the nutrients your pup needs and the prebiotic blend Active Biome Plus that supports healthy digestion. PetSmart, anything for pets.